Hey everyone, it's Greg from the Plastic Crap Blog, and today I am joined by Steve. And one of the things that we want to do is talk a little bit about how new people get into Infinity as a war game. I suppose you're particularly interested in talking to Steve because it was his first war game, and I found that quite different from the people that I've usually spoken to. So, welcome, Steve.
Hi.
Currently at the moment, can you tell me a little bit about your Infinity as a whole? So, if I remember rightly, you started off with Ariadna.
I did, yeah. So I got in. I sort of played a bit ages and ages and ages ago when a mate got Ice Storm, and that was his. So we played it around his house. He got all the models. I played a few games. We sort of went through the starter missions of Ice Storm. And he's like, I know how this works. This is a great game. I can play this. I'm going to go and buy this great new US Ariadna box set that's just been released. Got
Okay.
completely hooked on the videos and watched all the different bits I could about it, and thought I knew everything. Got Ariadna.
So if that was kind of when you started, roughly how long have you been playing?
Think that's probably about, I'm going to guess that's 3 years ago, maybe three and a half.
Okay, so yeah,
Something
okay, so that's a lot longer
like
than I
that.
was thinking.
Maybe I may be lying. It might be like, it's definitely more than two.
Okay.
I'm
Okay.
sure it was Northern Open 3 or 4 that I first met you at. So that
Yeah.
was, they're on like double figures now, aren't they?
Yeah, they are sort of, I think it's number 10 now. So yeah, you're right. I suppose we first met, I think primarily through the Northern Open, which has been a way that I've met quite a few people, that have been on here now. So I guess thinking about your gaming history as a whole, because as I understand it, you didn't just jump straight into Infinity. How did you kind of get there?
Okay, so this was, so I didn't probably take what people would probably have as the standard route. So I've started board gaming really, mainly through mates at work and things like that, sort of saying, oh, I've got this, do you fancy giving it a go? And me and a couple of mates got really hooked on Pandemic,
Great
which is
game.
obviously nothing like a war game, but it's a really fun game. And I really enjoyed the cooperative thing. I felt like it was actually kind of, something you could talk through, you could be quite social with. The old cogs kept turning all the time, so he was always thinking about what was going on. And I really enjoyed the narrative with it. Every game felt a bit different, depending what character you played, depending how you play the game. And that got me a bit hooked, because actually this was when I was probably early 20s, mid 20s. So
Okay.
that was still, probably quite late for gaming. It's not sort of a thing, even the board game stuff's not a thing I've been doing since I was kind of an early teen or anything like
Yeah.
that. And that kind of sat there sort of semi-dormant in the background, and would have a game every now and again. And then my now wife, fiance, no, girlfriend at the time, her best friend had us over for a weekend, and I got to know her boyfriend, who's, oh God, this has got really confusing. Her boyfriend, who's now her husband as well, so that's all changed in all those years. But yeah, my mate Phil, who had just started, well, he hadn't just started, he had been into miniatures probably from the more traditional kind of route, but hadn't really played anything for ages. And he had got a load of X-Wing stuff. So we started
Right.
chatting about, this was that kind of get to know new people thing for me, because I'd been with my girlfriend for a few months, started to meet her friends, started to get more socially involved. And what, is that sort of what are you into? And one of the things that came up was Star Wars.
Yeah.
And I think that's probably an easy way into conversation for most blokes. So we talked Star Wars a fair bit. We watched a few clips of different kind of fan edits and things like that. And then Phil said, oh, I've got a board game style thing. I've never really played it, but shall we have a look? And between us, over a few visits, we figured out X-Wing and started getting into that quite a bit.
Okay.
And it was interesting, because it kind of, for me, it was that kind of, I'm sure there's loads of X-Wing fans that are going to probably throw things at the screen now. But for me, it was almost that thing of, it's a bit like a board game, but it's got a lot more to it. So
Yeah.
you kind of got figurines that were pre-painted and looked really attractive. you got all the card element of it, but then you got the rulers and the big table, and you got all the sort of cutting way missions could go and the way you had to react to what the opponent was doing. And that was really interesting. It was really new to anything else I'd done. And it, what I really liked was that was a quite an interesting way in, because actually it was Star Wars, so I knew the ships a bit, I knew sort of the character concepts a bit, I knew sort of the weapons without having to really think about it. And we played a few games of that. But again, it was not quite the thing that ticked every box. It was a good entrance, but both Phil and I felt that wasn't the game that we wanted to play.
Okay.
And Phil in particular spent ages researching different games out there just for something of interest. And Phil, you met Phil.
Yeah,
Really good model painter, and he's won quite a lot of sort of awards and things for it on different competitions. And he got interested in Infinity through the models, really. And he found the Operation Ice Storm box set, put that all together. He's a slow painter and he's a perfectionist. So this was that kind of got forgotten about, and we played more games of X-Wing and tried a few board games again and tried to add another go at Pandemic and things like that. And then went on to the first sort of opening trainee missions of Ice Storm.
Okay.
And that was, it was really cinematic. So we would play a small low point 4-character game and then discuss everything we did until it was kind of gone midnight and we realized we've spent far longer than this on this little mission than we really should have done. And we loved how sort of the AROs worked, how you were always thinking, you were always busy. And we didn't really know the rules that well, but we had a sort of theory of, well, if this was real world, what would happen?
Yeah.
And that started loads of discussions, because it's like, oh, actually, you could do this and it would make something else happen. And maybe you could do this. And then we'd go and look it up and say, yeah, that would work. And then over the course of the next week or two, we'd end up having a load of kind of messenger conversations of, actually, when you did this, wouldn't it have been great if you'd have done this instead? Or if I'd have done that as a reaction. And it really, really built an enthusiasm for it. So that was my route. It was a really unplanned, slow route through different people and different friends, because Phil wasn't even the person that got me into Pandemic originally.
Okay.
It was just a strange route from board game to Infinity.
I suppose what's interesting for me is you're talking about you joined and it, I suppose Ice Storm had come out, and I guess when I first got back in, well, I first got into Infinity when I was about 18, so we're talking sort of 11 years ago. And at that time, it didn't have those sort of elements to it. There was a rule book and there was miniatures and still boxes, unit boxes, but not big boxes like the US Ariadne or the Steel Phalanx or Toha. And there was no, here is everything, go and play. So I almost wonder whether, whilst the miniatures were still beautiful, if you'd come at a different time, I wonder whether you would have joined.
There would have been a barrier, wouldn't there? There would have hugely been a barrier, because for me, it was still that, here's a box of stuff and some instructions.
Yeah.
We're going to help you do this.
Yeah. Is that something of like, here's everything you need to get going? There's also something it sounds like really significant in that it was 2-player. You both, yeah. It came with a set for each of you that kind of Phil was able to invest in. So,
yeah, because I'll be dead honest, I wouldn't have spent money on miniatures at that stage.
Okay.
So the fact that Phil had got the set, it got 2 sets, he knew all about painting, because I never painted a thing. I didn't know, you know. Later on, when I got my USA box set, I had a real thing of, God, I don't even know what glue to use, you know.
Yeah.
How do you glue metal together? Well, I've done Airfix, but that was plastic. That's not going to work. Right, Google, help. And even had to figure that out and started watching the various videos and things that you could find online quite quickly. And it's like, oh, that's actually quite simple. I'll give that a go. And got into kind of sort of building and painting then. But I wouldn't have done that without having played the game a bit.
Yeah, definitely. Because I suppose the majority of people, like you say, you got into it at a reasonably sort of later stage in life. And I suppose most people that I know have been playing since they were kids. And in the boxes that Games Workshop used to do, it used to come with paints, brushes, and miniatures, and potentially a little bit of glue. So it sounds like from a gaming perspective, it was already set up for you. But the hobby side of things, it kind of didn't have that initial here you go kit.
Yeah, and I think that's the thing, because if you start as a board game, you just get little wooden counters. You don't really have to think about any of that. You can buy it and play it that evening. And to be fair, the first miniatures game we played was X-Wing for that reason.
I suppose so. When you first moved over to give Infinity a try, then, from what I know from other people and my own experience of moving into Infinity, people have said that it's reasonably intimidating because A, because of the rule set, because it's not a you go might you go I go sort of game, but also the hobby side. I mean, what was that like approaching, it seems a reasonably intimidating hobby.
Yeah. It was interesting because I think we both felt we knew what was going on after we'd played a few Ice Storm missions. We looked at going to an event, I think it was in Birmingham. For whatever reason, that didn't then happen. But the plan at that time was still, I hadn't got any models then. That was literally, okay, there's a few models here that are blue and there's a few models here that are red. You take them, I'll take these, and we'll go and play games. And we actually thought that would happen. We actually thought we would do well because, we had played some games together and one of us had won some of them and things like that. And I then started to think, okay, I want to play more of these games. And I found a group in Bolton where, so the Bolton Gnome guys, they were playing and they'd started their own little Escalation League at the time. They were about halfway through that, but I messaged Ben and said, I've seen you guys. Can anyone come along? And he sort of said, yeah, we are in the middle of an escalation league, but more than happy for you to join. And I expected to be able to go and play and actually do really well because I've been doing really well on these Ice Storm games. And I just got plastered. I didn't know what had hit me. Ben was doing all these crazy things, and I was playing the other guys, like, I don't even know what that is. And I found like there was a whole set of rules I just didn't even know existed. I mean, those guys were ace because they would you could turn up and they would all be there wanting to play a game. So their mentality for Infinity was perhaps a bit different to some of the other sort of group things I've done since, where you've almost pre-organized your game. We would turn up and play a game when we got there, and there would probably be quite small point games as well for a start. So it was full rules, which I wasn't used to, but it was still similar point sizes perhaps to some of the larger starter missions from Ice Storm. And I think that helped a fair bit. And I think a lot of that was the slow build up through an escalation league. And I think certainly, so they had played some games in their escalation league, so they were all starting to learn it. They'd also been playing games before the escalation league, I think, as well. And this for me was where I realized A, how much I didn't know, and B, how simplified some of the starter missions were.
Definitely.
And that was, yeah, that was probably a bit of a naivety.
Okay. So thinking about then how you so you've gotten into to this group, and I suppose that sounds like really supportive in the sense that you could quite regularly just turn up and get a game on a club night. How did it then get to a point, because unlike other games, I suppose, excuse me, unlike other games, you can have stores that you just play games in, and you can almost do that for years. And Infinity itself is very much built around the ITS system and going to tournaments. Not necessarily, it is competitive, but it's not hyper competitive. So, how did you get to a point then where you went to the Northern Open and we met?
So that was the Bolton group. So they started talking about it. So at that point, we'd finished the Escalation League. I think we'd probably finished the second Escalation League. I can't really remember. And they all started saying, oh, shall we all go to Leeds? And it was a real group thing. And I was a bit apprehensive. I think some of them had been before. And they all just said, yeah, it's a really good day. Everyone's friendly. Everyone's welcoming. And I was like, well, I'm probably not going to place very well. It's like, doesn't matter. Just turn up. You'll have a good time. And to be fair, I had a great time. It was, and I can remember. So the f I actually remember the first game I played there. I think I played Aaron, who's one of the organisers.
Yeah.
And it was because the guy I was meant to play was randomly picked out of the hat or however they did that. The guy I was meant to play just didn't turn up.
Okay.
And I felt like a real Billy. And so I was basic, and Aaron was TO and he wasn't playing that day. So I was basically the kid batting a tennis ball against a wall, hoping the wall would play back.
That's really funny you say that, because the first time I went the Northern Open before that, would have been 3, and I think you came to 4.
Yeah.
I turned up incredibly hungover. It was my first ever tournament, and I had no one to play, so I ended up playing Ed. So there's got to be like some sort of tradition, maybe.
It's a rookie entry thing. It's a right, you've got to pass, you know.
Yeah.
You've got to feel like a Billy for your first game, otherwise it's just not tennis. what did me real damage though, because I was playing Aaron, who had not planned to be playing a game, hadn't really prepared a list, he wasn't in tournament mind, he was running around and helping people organize things and know the rules mindset.
Yeah.
So I was doing some crazy things with Van Zandt, which, you know, everyone loves. And I killed... Oh, actually, it wasn't Van Zandt. It was the Airborne Ranger. But yeah, I killed Joan of Arc.
Okay.
He was gutted. He was absolutely like, no one does this. This shouldn't happen. How have you done this? That was the only lucky dice roll I've had in 4 years, by the way.
Yes. Yeah.
I killed Joan of Arc. And I don't think I won the game, but it was a pretty good sort of even match, which set me up for a lot of pain for the rest of the day.
Yeah.
And I remember, I think the third mission or the third mission of that was where I met you.
Okay. I'm not too good at recalling that sort of thing, but...
Well, the main words you said there were, sorry, Steve.
Yeah.
Sorry, Steve.
Yeah, I think it was kind of a brutal matchup because I've been playing quite regularly. I've done Wargame for a long time.
Yeah.
And it was my Toha with their viral rifles against you and your squishy Ariadnas.
Yeah. With a link team in a teardrop shape.
Yeah. And everyone has to learn that, what flamers and shotguns do.
Yeah. But you know what I got from that? And I can't remember who I played for the middle mission. I just can't remember. Probably one of the Bolton guys, actually.
Okay.
What I remember thinking was how many people I'd met that I just had a good laugh with.
Yeah, yeah.
And I think I'd got a few points. I certainly wasn't bottom of the table. I was quite pleased with that. I think I drew the first game. I think that got me enough points to be like 2 or 3 places from bottom. And I thought, well, actually, from not really knowing loads about what's been going on here, that's not bad.
Yeah.
And I just remember sort of getting home sort of really tired, but having had a really good day. And that was it. I was kind of a bit hooked then for the tournament thing. So I think I sort of signed up for the next one as soon as I think at that stage it was becoming a bit known.
Yeah.
But the next one, I think I was on like someone's stag do or something, and
yes,
nipping the toilet to sign up before all the places went.
Yeah, definitely. I think there's many a time when we've been in weird situations and everyone's sort of hovering on the computer half an hour before Northern Open tickets go online. I suppose thinking about where you've placed in terms of tournaments and how you've been doing, I suppose you're quite renowned for having bad luck and bad dice. And I think you're not necessarily the most tactical of people because you haven't played for years and years like the rest of us. How have you found Infinity as a game in terms of progressing your skills and your abilities to win?
Okay. So I've struggled a bit. I think what's been... So after the Bolton stuff, I started meeting some people at the Preston Harlequins group as well, started going there, which was actually my local group. And Lawrence... who organises all the tournaments there, has been really good. So at the time I was still playing Ariadna, and he was Ariadna as well, and sort of said, I'm going to give you a bit of help here. And we started playing sort of trainee missions. And Lawrence is really great. He will organise things. He's organised a lot of escalation leagues, a lot of tournaments at Harlequins and things like that. So I started getting quite a large pool of people to play against.
Okay.
And a lot of them hadn't really played themselves much. but a lot of them had wargaming backgrounds.
Okay.
So at that point, I probably knew the rules relatively well, but just didn't know how to win a war game.
Okay.
They perhaps didn't necessarily know the rules, but had played loads of war games. So between us, we got some pretty good matches. So that got me practicing, and I started realizing that I wanted to try a different army.
Okay.
Went and I started to build on a left set, started playing a left, and tried different tactics. At that point, I instantly forgot everything Lawrence had helped me learn as Ariadne. And waded in with Achilles and Hector and Plasma and shot everything dead and started winning a few games.
Okay.
And I got quite proud of myself and I got quite excited thinking, I've learned this game. I know what's going to happen here. And then when Lawrence did another tournament, I signed up for that. Loads of people I knew from other tournaments came along, including, I think, yourself again, and Luke and the Scottish guys and all of that. And I still just got floored because I'd forgotten that I was playing against people that didn't really know how to play the game very well.
Yeah, and to be fair though, Steve, I think we have a tournament scene, especially in the north, where we have some very, very good players. Yeah, so I think it is pretty tough to try and take first with the sort of guys that we play against.
But so what I think where I was probably going with that, and I've probably rambled on a bit, but I think what I'm aware is what I learned there is probably that people come in with a plan,
Okay.
and I don't think I do.
Okay. Okay.
I think so one thing I've taken it from a minute, a lot of so I've been playing more sort of games with people in Preston that we perhaps don't even aim to finish the game, but we aim to talk around a lot of what's happening.
Okay.
With a real kind of, okay, so if this happens, what should we look at doing? How might we do something about it? And I've had games where we don't even finish the first turn, let alone the first round, and it gets to time we really need to head home.
Okay.
But what's interesting from that is the debate, and I liken it to almost a catch up with your mates at the pub, except you're at a gaming room. So it's a good night, you still have a good time. But you might have two or three people sat around a table, sort of saying, "Well, how about if this happened or that, or you did that?" So I think for me, I need to learn from games like that and start planning a list more and plan and looking at a mission and planning how a list is going to approach a mission.
Sure. I was going to ask Steve whilst you were talking about that. Is there anything in particular that your group have built scenarios around to practice to achieve? Is there anything that maybe you as newer players have struggled with?
Oddly, I actually think the first 10 minutes of a game, I think the deployment
Yeah.
and almost thinking how and why to deploy is a huge part of it. So I think it's a combination of that and some list building, and then probably knowing what to do with it once you've got past the deployment as well. So I genuinely think I've lost games within that first 10 minutes before.
Okay.
I think possibly a better player would have pulled them back. Or a
Yeah.
more experienced player would have pulled them back. But I definitely think I've, and it can be, it's not just deployment, it's choosing whether to go first or second.
Sure.
Choosing the wrong deployment, choosing the wrong initiative, all that sort of thing. And actually finding before you know it, your opponent's taken over half the table and secured two or three objectives.
Yeah. And I think from what you're saying there, like even you've got those early in-game decisions, but they are almost mirroring to a wider picture where you need to choose your list if you're thinking about, right, well, I'm going to go first for this mission to achieve these things. It's all very much interlinked. And I suppose if you're missing one of those steps because you've not previously thought about it or not given much value to it, then it will sort of be quite difficult.
Yeah, and I've noticed, so we've got some really interesting people, I think, at present who have got different backgrounds. So there's a few guys who are very into X-Wing, so they're quite used to stacking up the odds to make them work in their favour when they build a list. So perhaps some former hacker that or baggage bot or something that builds up the characteristics of something else.
Okay, so a bit synergy.
Yeah, and there's people that are definitely doing some clever things like that. I think people have built some really clever lists, which really help certain missions. And I think what I do is almost aim for that magic 300 and tick a box.
So, going forward then, Steve, what are you going to put into consideration so that you improve as a gamer?
So I'm, yeah, I've been having a think about this, and I think my first thing really is to look at, and I've not done it yet. I need to try doing this. I need to prove it works because this is really a theory I've just, I need, so my biggest thing I think is time. And I think we all reach that stage where we have got life outside of gaming as opposed to perhaps the sort of mid-teenager who could probably spend a week obsessing over the list ready for the next game.
Sure.
So for me, I think the biggest thing is probably reading the mission and understanding what might be needed to complete that mission.
Okay.
So, what specialists might get an advantage, whether there's a forward deployment that might help gather something before someone else does. And equally building the lists with some synergy so characters are giving each other the benefits that they need. So I think probably for me the work that I need to do is probably more in that build up than it is the game itself.
Yeah, that's quite an interesting point, sort of almost doing homework, sort of reading about units, trying to
Yeah.
see what might work and studying the missions.
Because there's a bit of a joke about my dice. They are, and I've played some games recently that have done quite well, and there's been genuine kind of comments of, "Have you touched my dice?" Lawrence has organised a little tournament over the course of the past month, and the first two games I played against Dave and Arthur, they both, not knowing the previous or the next game, to not knowing the other person said this, but what did you do to my dice? And they were just having bad rolls, and I was just critting them.
Okay.
Which is always nice, but I think sometimes the dice thing's a bit of a misnomer. I think perhaps an okay decision, which perhaps doesn't give you as good a chance of success as you might hope it does, might could be conceived as bad luck with dice.
Sure. So kind of maybe if you were to take shots more in certain range bands or to stack the odds doing certain things. You know, you might have a better chance of succeeding. And again, that's going to come from experience of reading the situation. Do I shoot this? Do I not?
Yeah, because someone mentioned to me the other week about how I put my link team together. I think it might have been Luke actually, or your cohort in crime. I think it was him. I'm sure it was him saying basically my link team seemed to either be all short range or all long range, rather
Okay.
than someone that perhaps a link team that's got a flamer, maybe a couple of mid range, and maybe a missile launcher or something to go for long range. So maybe use those five characters to cover every sort of part of the board rather than just looking at trying to get close and getting killed before you get there.
Okay. Yeah, that's an interesting thing, I think. And it only really comes for me from those discussions, like you said, about meeting up with people, actively engaging on Facebook chats, looking at forums, and seeing how other people do things. Because there are some things you or I would never have guessed in a million years actually work, or very minor tactics. One of the things
And that's the homework I don't do at the minute, and that's the homework I think I need to do.
Definitely. So thinking about as we're sort of maybe wrapping up, I guess, this kind of interview as a whole, could you think of maybe three top tips for brand new gamers that haven't played war games before but are looking at Infinity?
Yeah, sure. I think so. The biggest thing for me is the group I'm in now. I love turning up on a Wednesday evening at Harlequin's and meeting the people, having a game. I think if you're interested, everyone I've met without, I can't think of any exception, whether it be in Leeds or Bolton or Preston, is pleased to meet someone else who wants to play that game. So if you're thinking about playing it, turn up and say hi.
Okay.
I think a group. So I think that's the biggest thing that's changed it for me is that team. So rather than just playing with one mate, it was a whole group of people with different armies and different ideas. So it never gets dull.
Okay. Yeah.
I think the next thing is probably, and this is a bit I've not really talked about, but a bit for me is the next thing I think is make sure you paint your army well,
Okay.
which is not about tactics or anything, but I think when, especially if you go to a group that's got good terrain. If you're playing with little silver dudes that you can't quite tell the difference who's who, and neither can your opponent, so it gets a bit messy, I think it can be a bit uninspiring.
Okay, so sort of
And
keeping morale up.
so I mean, I found, especially with the army painter stuff, I found the Ariadne stuff really easy to just spray green and put some tufts of grass on the bottom of and things like that. And quite quickly, it didn't look, I wasn't going to win awards, but it looked quite good on a table, especially with a table with someone else that got well painted stuff.
Okay.
And I think everyone I've played with has sort of enjoyed the sort of cinematic approach to how cool a certain scene looks when a thing happens. So we've not talked a lot about it really, but I went on to a Leff for a little while. And the only reason I stopped playing Leff again was because I couldn't figure out a nice way to paint them.
Okay.
And I just got really bored of these dull grey things. I did the whole airbrush thing, and after three different layers of primer for Zenith priming, followed by three different layers of different shades of grey, ended up with flat grey. And I can't stand them because every time I see them, I see all the paint that went into a flat grey model.
Oh.
So I don't want to use those guys now.
Okay.
So I'd probably say pick an easy way to paint your models so that they look good, and actually go in with nice, well-painted models. So at least you feel a bit of pride about
Okay.
that. And the third thing's homework, because it's the one thing I'm missing now.
Okay.
You
Definitely.
learn what your army does, learn enough about other armies so that if they're doing a thing, it doesn't take you by surprise.
Yeah, and I suppose as a fair point to you though, Steve, I suppose I find myself even after playing for years and years and playing this sole game as my main game for years and years, I'm still having to find out more about hacking, more about mines, where do I place my HVT for advantage and doing
Yeah, it
crazy
never
tricks
ends,
with
does
it.
it? I
It
don't
does,
think anyone can claim they know everything.
no, and you have to play against other people to learn different armies. The only thing I found is buying as many of them as I can is that I
That's
started to learn the different ones.
the
Yeah, a little bit.
expensive route.
But perhaps maybe there's something in there about swapping armies with a buddy so that you can try
Yeah.
something different.
Yeah, and I think that's, yeah, the whole group thing just works for that, doesn't it?
Yeah,
I think
definitely.
finding a good group's probably
The
a
key
big way
underpinning of
in.
it.
Yeah.
Definitely. Well, thank you very much, Steve. It's been a pleasure talking to you and finding out how it was with Infinity being your first war game. And hopefully that's shed a little bit of light to some people who have been looking but not starting.
Yeah, I hope I don't put anyone off. I'm sure other people can start and maybe not roll bad dice constantly. Yeah, I'm sure I'm not the role model.
We have to have Will Wheatons of the gaming world.
Yeah.
So, cheers, Steve.
Cheers, Greg.